Picture a world where AI is being illustrated via comic books. You can marry a hologram or even your virtual chatbot partner. Deep learning algorithms are being applied to detect internationally banned weapons via acoustic recognition. And all of these events are not happening in some distant future. They have already unfolded around us over the last 12 months alone. AI has made the leap from science fiction to science fact, for better or for worse. And today I want to talk to you about the shift from artificial intelligence to heartificial intelligence. And I stand here today as someone who's navigated the world of the most algorithm-driven experiences to the most human experiences, from the cutting-edge world of corporate advertising and launching an ethical AI platform to the front lines of humanitarian disasters. And despite being viewed through vastly different lenses, AI has been my constant. And it's from navigating these different crossroads that I've encountered much of the keys that continue to unlock the hype, the hope, and the hubris that surrounds the next frontier, a artificially intelligent future. And this is underpinned by three things: ethics, intimacy, and humanity. But first, I want to share a story with you of the spark that lit my AI curiosity. And I was less than 9 months into my first job ever, straight out of university. And one day I got a call from my line manager at the time, and he said, "Look, our chief analytics officer can't attend this conference in the US. Would you be up for going instead?" I thought, me? Really? The most junior person in the company? I wasn't even over the legal drinking limit in the US, but I was over the moon to be considered. So I made the journey from London to Florida, and it was there that the purpose of this conference quickly dawned on me. It was to launch a little piece of software known as IBM Watson. So for those who aren't familiar, at the time, IBM Watson was one of the most advanced AI supercomputers, most famous for defeating one of the top human experts on the game show Jeopardy. But more than this, it was actually a breakthrough in natural language processing for consumer and enterprise-level technologies. So I went about my business, roaming the exhibition floors, and I had been pre-warned to expect to be approached with a barrage of sales pitches. But to my surprise, I was surrounded by the real magicians, the developers. And I watched them speak and saw their eyes light up as they dove into the intricacies of neural networks. And I suddenly realized this wasn't just about selling a product. This was about potential. The potential to extend our capabilities and enhance our understanding via systems that could learn, predict, and interpret in ways we were only just beginning to understand. So as we moved on, and after the next few months, my newfound fascination with how whole lines of text turned into whole worlds pushed me to pursue my own master's in machine learning and natural language processing. And it stays with me today as someone who invests in mentoring and working with far better engineers than me, who build even bigger, grander worlds than the ones I could imagine. But more importantly for me that day, the conference underscored something crucial. AI will not outsmart humans. Those who understand how to harness this technology will. And what if I told you that AI is being released with fewer safety standards and less oversight than that required to manufacture an oven? Yeah, an oven. So the goal of AI ethics is to create trustworthy systems that are safe, reliable, and beneficial to humanity. Focus in this space usually tends to be concentrated into four key areas, and that's AI ethics, trolley questions, the existential threat that AI could pose to humanity, as well as obviously data, security, and privacy. And it's really important to note that none of these concerns is unique to AI specifically. I actually became fascinated with the space, not by all of the problems that persist in the space, but actually by being enveloped in the pockets of silence. And here's what I mean when I say this. So in keynotes and workshops, I would usually flash up this slide. Oh. And what it would do is ask us to confront ourselves with the trolley question of what we would do when faced with such an ethically thorny issue. So a driver is driving along in their car, and they can A, save the driver or collide with a pedestrian, and their pedestrian is killed, or B, the driver collides with a barrier and is killed, but the pedestrian is saved. And this exercise is really useful because it shows us how hard making such a decision would be in practice. So in every room I presented this in, whether it was to 80 execs at a retail conference or to a small group of developers within a startup, some would raise their hands for option A and others for option B. But it was usually the large number of people who did not raise their hands at all that surprised me the most. And this is because when we stay silent, we are leaving our power on the table in the debate around ethical AI, and it's so crucial because it impacts every single one of us. And this is more than a missed opportunity at an individual level. It also represents a collective loss and a narrowing of the lens through which AI's trajectory is viewed and determined. And the particular problem of the trolley problems is really powerful for us because it forces us to confront and reflect on our own values and biases. And why? Because imperfect humans make imperfect algorithms. And how these imperfections manifest is referred to as bias. And while AI might be multilingual, it really is monocultural. Current narratives that exist in the space for this technology are mainly being built for the Western world. And when we think about how it's portrayed in science fiction and media, AI is often most commonly found as super intelligent, destructive forces and beings, as I'm sure we can all recognize through the Terminator. Yet, we think about countries like Japan. How is this being represented? Well, it's a completely different story. This cute little guy, Doraemon, is the most adorable robotic earless cat. So Doraemon made his debut actually 24 years before the Terminator came onto the scene. And the depiction here is that he is a robotic cat that defies time and space to help a boy named Nobita. But this, in a nutshell, encompasses the challenges we're seeing in the gap between different cultures for AI technology. And this is also reflected in language. A gap is widening because language is more than a mere tool for communication. It is the very fabric that weaves together our thoughts, identities, and emotions. We built gods on language, and we created humanity on language. All of the institutions that exist today, governments, religion, human rights, and so many more, exist thanks to language and our ability to use it and reshape it to our own will. Yet, ChatGPT understands English and minimally knows only 50 other languages. Why? Because large language models, which underpin platforms like ChatGPT, are really good at translating English into other languages, but they struggle when it comes to being able to process languages such as Arabic, Korean, those that are actually built on non-Latin scripts. And therefore, these are commonly referred to as low-resource languages, simply because there is not enough data that exists out there, and therefore, we cannot build robust enough systems as a result. So as we seemingly question how more and more neutral technology can go astray, it's really clear that there needs to be broader representation in the design, development, deployment, and governance of artificial intelligence. The underrepresentation of women, people of color, and different cultures, and the undersampling of these groups is leading to technology that is being optimized for only a small portion of our world. After all, culture is in the code, and the code is in the culture. And by the age of 23, I'd worked with almost 50 brands on their advertising and digital transformation strategies. In digital marketing, it's no longer enough to just generate impressions. Brands have to create a lasting impact, a memorable moment that elicits action and evokes emotion. Which is why attention has long been one of the main battlefields in the fight for the consumer. Yet, when we think about our daily lives, if you've ever opened Netflix or social media, the TV series or films, stories or social posts that you see displayed on your screen would look completely different from mine or even some of your friends and family. And this is because these platforms utilize a sorting algorithm designed to keep and attract our attention for as long as possible. These are more than just content suggestions that you're seeing. These platforms have become digital matchmakers, aimed to create algorithms that are able to understand our user interests, behaviors, purchase histories, and so many other unique factors, and deliver highly personalized content to us back as a result. So now, instead of merely vying for attention, brands and businesses can compete for something far more valuable here: intimacy and emotional connection. And by 2035, our relationship between humans and machines, bots and systems powered mainly by autonomous and artificial intelligence, will push you to reconsider what level of intimacy you are willing to have with AI technology. An intimacy is traditionally associated with physical proximity and shared experiences, but it now extends far beyond into the digital realm. And this is because AI companions sit on a broad spectrum of interactions that are primarily productive to those that engage with us on emotional, intellectual, and even affectionate levels. It is this gap that is creating a new era for how we will perceive this technology. And the way that we continue to look at this is also being mirrored in current systems that are augmenting human care. So AI is already looking at and diagnosing Alzheimer's and supervising children. Pet avatars are watching over dementia patients, and chatbots are helping veterans to treat their PTSD. It is this algorithmic intimacy that I hope will expect to continue and power much of our closeness with technology as we move forward. Because there's one thing we need to overcome first before actually understanding how this technology will help shape a better humanity for us all. And that's that actually we've become so focused and fixated on enhancing intelligence and even intimacy that we might just be losing sight of what it means to augment kindness and the benefits this will bring. And this is where altruistic AI fits into the picture. And the aim with this is not to create sentient beings, but actually to create systems that shape the betterment of our society. And this is because while the world starts to feel more connected than ever for most of us, smartphones, laptops, social media, the constant email blizzard, by the end of this year alone, 130 million people will be forcibly displaced from their homes. And for this staggering number of people, and for many more that will remain unaccounted for, the world is actually becoming more fragmented. Being forced to leave your home does not create ties, it severs them. Now imagine a humanitarian aid worker, and in the first day, up to 140,000 people can be expected to arrive where they're stationed at a border checkpoint. All of these people, vulnerable, and many of them with casualties after suffering grueling journeys of 18 hours or even longer. This was a day that became my new normal when I was stationed between the Ukraine and Poland, and there were really difficult decisions to be made. Should I provide aid immediately, or should I instead take stock of the situation so that scarce resources could be distributed far more efficiently? And the question of what makes crisis response deployments successful is never straightforward, which is why organizations, and more importantly, those on the ground, often face difficult choices of how to prioritize resources under immense pressure. And during the first week of being between Poland and Ukraine, I met some of the first few thousands of people that had managed to make it to safety. And we were all there in full force: military, NGOs, aid workers, individual contributors who just threw on a high-vis jacket. And we had the usual aid supplies, and behind me, we can see one of the rest centers that was set up. And in the centers, we had all of the usual things: thermo blankets, nappies, bandages. We realized there was one thing that was missing. As people started coming over in the troves, we'd missed power banks. They'd left their loved ones behind, and some had been separated along the way. And when they arrived, their devices had all run out of battery. For me, this was crucial, because it proves that in this space, humanitarian sector at large, modern problems require modern solutions. And I expect that this algorithmic intelligence will continue to power far more tremendous opportunities in the humanitarian space by allowing organizations to respond more swiftly and effectively to disasters around the world. And we're seeing it take shape with drones delivering emergency supplies, AI-driven predictive modeling, and even blockchain-enabled transparency to track aid throughout the distribution network. These are the innovations that are shaping a brighter future for those most in need. So AI has made the leap from science fiction to science fact. and it's simply referred to as fiction when it struggles to stay ahead of technology. In order for us to stay ahead of technology, we need to start to ask ourselves, not what AI will do to me, ask yourself what AI can do for me. The power of AI does not lie on the table for the taking. It requires active engagement from each and every one of us. Whether you are a builder or user of artificial intelligence technology, we all have an active role in shaping it into a force that amplifies human potential across every single sphere. I've been lucky enough to innovate with and observe small but mighty groups of creatives, coders, and developers. But the world only changes when all of us, not just the scientists and engineers, but ordinary people, you in this room here today, and so many more outside of it, step into the light, because there's never been a better time to do so and to shape the future that you want to see, not just consume the one given to you. And I'm really optimistic that we can course correct our society towards a artificially intelligent one, where we pivot our genius, not away from efficiency, but towards humanity, where we measure progress, not by the number of teraflops of calculations, but by the number of lives improved and empowered. A world where AI is more than the sum of our hearts. Thank you.